Hey, it's Anna Runyon, and I want to announce something very special we're doing for the next 15 episodes of the Classy Career Girl podcast. We are going back in time to 2012 to give you the top episodes of all time, and it's going to be really exciting. The reason we're doing this is because my family and I are taking a little vacation for the month of November, and we're going to New Zealand. Now, of course, we're going to be doing a little work, but I wanted these episodes to go out so you guys can kind of see where we've been, what the journey that we've been on at Classy Career Goal. We've been doing this since 2012, so I wanted you to get a peek behind the scenes of the old stuff. Even if you are just joining us, if you've been around for a while, I think you're going to really love it. So let's dive in over the next 15 episodes to our top Classy Career Girl episodes of all time.
Are you feeling stuck in your career? Have you been passed by for a promotion? Or maybe you're having a hard time of seeing the road of opportunity ahead? Welcome to Breaking the Glass Ceiling, Going Beyond Expectations. I'm Dorothy Montgomery. Would you like to find a new career direction or expedite your career? Well, I believe most of us would. Meet Anna Runyon. Anna is a leadership coach and founder of one of the top career development blogs, ClassyCareerGirl.com, which recently made the Forbes Top 100 Websites for Your Career list and Forbes Most Influential Career Sites for 2014. She is a professor of management at DeVry University, and her career advice has been featured in Forbes, Yahoo Finance, and People Style Watch magazine. Anna is the voice for women who want to upgrade their leadership and accelerate their career success. And Anna is my guest on today's show. Welcome.
Thank you. I'm excited to be here.
I'm very excited to have you, and very excited to talk about the topic of how to accelerate your career, how to get unstuck. And Anna, one of the premise of the show is about the glass ceiling, but it's really about the inner glass ceiling. So it's about those limiting mindsets and beliefs that keep us from, you know, moving forward in our life or our career. And I want to hear from you. Have you ever been stuck? Have you ever hit your own glass ceiling?
Oh, yes. Yes, everything I do now is because of where I was and where I was once very, very stuck. And so now it's become really my passion is to help others get unstuck just because that it was so hard. I spent way too long being stuck in a career rut, and I don't want that to happen to anyone else. So I kind of put together a system that helps me get out of a career rut. It took me many years. So hopefully your listeners, it will take them a lot faster because you're, you know, helping them with this information and this radio interview. But yes, I definitely was stuck. I was stuck in a job that did not fit who I was. It didn't fit my interests. I was actually doing finance, and I was really great at it. I was getting promotions. I was, you know, excelling. My bosses were giving me all this praise, but inside it didn't fit my personality. It didn't fit my interests or my motivations. And so kind of went through a whole process. If you want me to, I can kind of get into more of kind of how I got unstuck, if you like.
Yeah, and before we go there, I want to share my story too of being stuck, because I think you and I have a similar story. So I think what we have in common, we both worked for male-dominated work environments. Is that true for you?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I worked in the defense environment. So yes, very male-dominated.
Yes. Yeah, so even going back, I grew up in a large family. I was the youngest one, and there were three girls and four boys, and actually the two oldest in the family were my sisters, and they were in college by the time I was coming up through grade school. And so in front of me were four boys. So I feel like I grew up with mostly men. And one day I remember I heard my parents talking, and they said this. I think I was about 10 years old when I heard this, but they said, "Our boys work harder than our girls." And I remember being devastated by hearing that. Maybe not more devastated as much as I was like, I'm going to show you that I can work harder than any guy. And I remember even talking to my parents about the comment. And really their comment was about the fact that my brothers were more, they were older, they were in high school, they were stronger to do some of the physical work. We grew up on a farm. And so that's what the comment was about. But the point of bringing that up is it bled into my life. I gravitated toward male-dominated areas and, like yourself, did very good. But just eventually, that was part of getting stuck. And I'm like you. I want to hear your story, how you got unstuck, and then I'll share mine too. But I have a feeling you could probably, I wish I would have talked to you a decade ago. You probably would have given me some great tips.
Oh, I don't think I knew all this a decade ago. But, get out then. But, I realized kind of what my interests were. I did a lot of personality assessments. I in my career, I tried to pick out things and have work experiences that really allowed me to kind of figure out what are those things I really enjoy doing. And the one thing that kind of caught my attention was I really liked being on this training team and teaching other people. And so that's one thing I kind of kept gravitating towards that, and I ended up becoming kind of an adjunct professor for my company and teaching a career or teaching a course on how to navigate your career. And that was like light bulb, like this is fun. I wasn't even getting paid for it. It was like my free time, but I just was enjoying it a lot. And then I was also, I still am an introvert. And so for me, networking was really, really difficult. And so that was a huge part of me getting unstuck. I knew that networking was key to reaching my career goals and kind of getting unstuck. And so once I was able to start doing more networking and meeting people, that really helped me get that clear direction and clarity of where I really wanted to go. And I actually, if anyone's been reading my blog for a long time, in 2011, I did a networking challenge. It was called a 4x4 networking challenge, where every month I met with 4 people I did know, but I wanted to get to know better, and 4 people I did not know, but I wanted to get to know. And that was a very life-changing year. It really taught me, you know, how to be more confident in myself and ask questions and talk to people. I kind of got out of my comfort zone. And then I ended up realizing the career that I really, really wanted to go into. So I think all those things combined with blogging and kind of documenting my journey and seeing kind of how to help other people, seeing the strengths I have and the things I really am passionate about, all those things kind of combined have kind of helped me see, you know, get unstuck and help me see kind of where my career is best fit for.
Okay, I have a blog idea for you. This actually inspired me. You know, so much we talk about networking and building that personal board of directors to help you guide your life, but you bring up a great point. If that's not your style, like you said, you were introverted.
Mm-hmm.
How would you help an introvert network? I think that would be a great blog, you know, networking for introverts. Because we forget about folks that, you know, have a different style in how they approach these things.
Yeah, the first thing is, I mean, being an introvert, I think I often thought of it as negative. I was like the shy girl, you know, labeled as the shy girl. And I thought, I was always like upset that I was an introvert. And so once I realized, you know, there are a lot of positive things about being an introvert. But as far as the networking goes, one of those positive things is we're really good listeners. We don't, you know, interrupt a lot. And so as an introvert, you really do have to figure out, you know, what type of networking works best for you. So a lot of clients that I've worked with are just really scared to go to a networking event and meet people they don't know. And so for them, there's nothing wrong with sitting down one-on-one, doing an informational interview, meeting someone for coffee, scheduling a phone call with someone. Those are really easy ways to network and to build that really personal relationship. The one thing I did through that year, I did a ton of informational interviews. And those are great for introverts because, well, if you don't know what they are, I should explain what they are. But it's when you go and you ask questions to someone who's in the career that you want, and you ask them, like, what's their typical day like? What do they enjoy about their job? What do they not enjoy? How could you get their type of career someday? And that's great for introverts because you have the questions all prepared. And so for introverts, you know, we like to prepare things in advance and not be caught off guard. Well, that's perfect for you. You have the questions. You can write them down. you're in charge of the interview, of asking them questions. You're not put on the spot. You might have to give an elevator pitch, but that's it. So that's what I would recommend for an introvert for networking.
You know, and I'm a strong believer in the informational interview because that's how I got unstuck. I actually had a mentor say to me, you know, what would you like to do in the next, you know, 5 to 10 years? And I'd already had a job where I worked on the national level, and I said, I'd really like to do the same work but on an international level. And so she recommended I go talk to someone who had that role, and I did. And just like you said, I basically said, what kind of skills, experience does it take to have this role, and how do you keep on top of, you know, global news and what's happening in the world? And just like you said, I had my plethora of questions, but what happened was I didn't realize it, but after I walked out of that informational interview, they were actually looking for someone to work with him. And they brought me back and said, you know, would you like to have this job? And it was my dream job. But it all came from just seeking someone out, and showing that passion and interest and saying, I'd love to be you someday. And
It definitely makes you stand out. It shows how proactive you are, and not that many people are doing them because it's kind of scary. You're putting yourself out there. You know, there's a lot to be scared about, but when you do them, it makes you stand out from the crowd, and people remember that. So I got a lot of the same response. I mean, I got a lot of job interviews throughout that whole process. I didn't get a job like you. That's awesome. My job kind of came later in a different way, but I did just get a lot of referrals, a lot of positive, like, wow, this is really great. Like, I'll definitely refer you to my company. So they're great to do.
So is that one of your recommendations for how to expedite or accelerate your career? What's your best advice for accelerating one's career?
Oh, there's so many different ways. So, I mean, I think definitely for the beginning part, when you're trying to figure out the right career and get that job that you really, really want, informational interviews are huge. Doing some sort of challenge of putting together like a networking challenge like I did, and also putting together kind of like your networking action plan. So, you know, we can get overwhelmed with all the networking events that we could go to. I'm here in San Diego. I could network every hour of every day if I wanted to. And so I think it's really important to watch your time and to be strategic about your networking. So, you know, kind of making that list of having that focused career target of where you want to go, and then start networking in that direction instead of, I'll go to this event or I'll go to this event. But you really want to meet those people that are going to help you find that career that you really want to go into. And it's the same way. If you are already in a career that you're happy at, it's the same for you, too. You want to make sure you have that. You're continually building your tribe, your network, continually putting together that networking action plan. So you're surrounding yourself with that tribe of people, those sources of influence, I call them, that are really going to help you when you need that promotion or when you want to take your career to that next level and get that raise. You want to know, have those people have your back and have them trust you and respect you. So it all falls in line, whether you're job searching, whether you're currently in a career, I mean, that you love, networking, creating that plan is really, really important.
And what I love about networking is, you know, I love the term, let's see if I can remember it, success is when preparedness meets opportunity. And to your point, I'm a prepared kind of person as well. And so I love the fact that networking is part of that. It's just a preparing kind of ritual that when that opportunity presents itself, you'll be in the right place at the right time with the right people. And that's kind of what happened to me when I got unstuck and got this job. The networking, you know, it sounds like it happened in a single moment, but it was actually years of building up the network. So it was a mentor who recommended a company that a friend of hers worked at, and then the gentleman I did the informational interview was just part of that, like you said, that tribe. Mm-hmm. But that was started years ago when I started planting those seeds of people to network with. And then one day you just say, hey, this is what I'm looking to do. This is my ideal dream job. And people hear that, and they start to work it for you.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's how I accelerated. But it doesn't happen overnight, to your point.
No.
It is something that's progressive. But, man, all of a sudden one day there's that tipping point, and all of a sudden you're right there when the opportunity presents itself.
Exactly. Yeah, that's a great point. Is you always, it's not just for when you're job searching. And I think this is a difference between men and women, too, because I do think men are building that, their boys network more often. You know, they're doing more things together throughout their career. But women, I mean, we have a lot of different things that we're juggling. And so I think women not always are putting that priority into networking and growing their career, especially when you bring in the families and, like, all this stuff that we're trying to organize in our careers and how hard we're working. It's something that often I see from my clients kind of goes on the back burner. So I'm glad we're talking about it and you're bringing it up again, because I think it's really important for the whole topic of your show, which is breaking the glass ceiling.
You bet. And I actually had a female colleague one time at a previous company I worked for. She called me up and she started to talk about the men in our department. And she said, "Do you know that they're having lunch or coffee or breakfast with the leader of our function, the leader of the department?" And I said, "And your point is, well, you know, they're schmoozing with him, et cetera." And so my next question to her was, "So why aren't you doing that?" And it caught her off guard, because I think, one, she didn't realize that men network very well. And two, like you said, she hadn't really given herself permission to do that. And I said, you know, I said, it's kind of one of those things, if you can't beat them, join them. You know, go do the same thing.
Exactly.
Go have lunch, go have, you know, an afternoon coffee, whatever. But get into that routine of networking with others. But I think she was shocked at my advice.
Yeah, no, that's a really good point when you're a woman working with a lot of men, and both of us had male-dominated work environments. The second that I said, as an introvert, you know, happy hours are something that I often wanted to avoid after work, especially when it was the group of men that I was working with. But when I said yes and I ended up going to those happy hours, the working relationships always improved the next day with those men, because it was, you know, it was a different kind of environment. You know, we were talking more about, you know, personal lives. I got to know where they lived, a little bit about their family, you know, and it just creates that trust that really will help, will pay off the next day in the office if you're working with men. Obviously, caveat, like, you have to know your values. I'm not saying, you know, do it. My whole branding is classy career girl. So you have to definitely know, you know, your values when you're going out with a bunch of men to happy hour. But it's really important for that building, that network, that relationship, and earning that trust the next day in the office.
I agree with that. And I have to tell you kind of a funny story. I recently talked to a woman leader who has worked in the beverage industry. It's been more like wine and spirits and the beer industry. So as a female leader, she often had to go out, you know, after a long days of meetings with her colleagues, to either a bar, and she said, you know, first of all, I don't want to drink that much because I'm going to, you know, take on the calories, but also I don't want to drink that much because I'm with colleagues and I don't want to, you know, get drunk, basically. So here's were some tricks that she used that kind of showed that she's still kind of drinking with the guys, but it was a way to control that. So she said, I always drank beer from a dark bottle so they couldn't see that I only drank half the beer. And she would work with the bartender beforehand to say, you know, I'm going to ask for another beer, but I'm not going to drink all of the first one, but, you know, bring another one. So she's only drinking very small quantities. And then she said when she worked for a spirits company, I think they would drink like gin and tonic kind of thing, but she would have a gin and tonic to start, but after that she'd ask the bartender to make it water with a lime. But that is the way that she still kind of stayed within the network of men, because it was expected that, you know, this is the product we sell. It's kind of expected that you drink it. But it was the way that she kind of kept her own style around it and her wits about her, but still looked like a drinking, you know, buddy, so to speak.
Interesting.
But I thought, you know, but what she was trying to do really is stay within that network, because she understood the importance of that. And part of that network was, you know, this is part of the things required. We have, you know, after dinner drinks, et cetera. But I love that she also held her feminine power around all of that as well.
Exactly. Yeah, knowing who you are and where your limits are too. I mean, is really, really important. You know, what, how much you can handle, how much you can't. Because you still, you know, you're still, you may not be in the office, but you still have to maintain that professionality. And you know, what you say or do could be potentially seen again. They'll remember that the next day in the office. So staying professional like she was is really important.
And that's what she said. They'll remember that. She said, if I don't drink, that's seen as, you know, it's not, it's seen as kind of a snub, right? And I hope the listener understands this story, but it's really about she still maintained that network, that colleagues. They thought she was one of them, but she didn't have to compromise, you know, how much she drank, so to speak. But
mm-hmm.
I thought it was just a clever way of looking like staying connected, but doing it in a way that she really felt a little bit more comfortable to do.
I like that. That's a good one. I might use that in the future because I do get asked a lot about those boys networking happy hours. And I think someone else just the other day was like, how am I supposed to get along with the boy, with all the men are drinking like fish? And so that might be a good way to handle it.
That's what I thought. You know, she just worked with a bartender before and how she wanted to manage through it. And they respected that and it worked. So, yeah, I was like you. I like that story. So I want to go back to that male-dominated piece. I want to share something with you, and I would love to see how you would have coached me at the time. So as I told you, I, too, was kind of – I gravitated toward male-dominated roles, and like yourself, I did well. But I kind of hit that glass ceiling because I had a colleague say this to me one day. I think I was putting down something that kind of had a female essence to it. And he said, why are you afraid to embrace the part of you that's feminine? He said, it seems like you shut that off, you know. And his point was, I think I was kind of doing the, you know, if I think and act like a man, I'll be successful. And he was actually calling me on that. And I've never forgotten this conversation because he's basically saying, why aren't you, you know, why aren't you proud to bring the female aspect into the workplace? I thought, wow, I didn't realize that that's what I was projecting.
Mm-hmm.
What's your advice for women who feel like when you are in male-dominated roles and you feel like you have to be one of the boys, how can we be more authentic and really embrace our feminine power? Any coaching you have on that?
Yeah, that's so important. And I actually had a similar experience, too, when I became a new manager. I tried to act like a man, too, you know, tried to be very hardcore and not, you know, let out my authentic self and kind of had to learn, you know, that who I really was and the type of leader that I was and the type of leader I wanted to be. But this is a very, very hot topic, and it's really, really important for women to understand that they bring these strengths to the office that men don't have. And actually, men actually want you on their team because of these strengths that you have and these skills that you have that they may be more lacking on. And we make a really, really great addition to a team. I know I've heard from one woman that when they would go into negotiations, they would always bring this one woman with them, even if, you know, she wasn't necessarily, you know, even the main person of the team. They always wanted her there because her perspective and what she would say, it always helped things move along more quickly and more effectively. There was just that presence of having a woman in the room just really made it more effective. And so I would tell you to determine what those female leadership strengths are. And in my book, which I know we're going to talk about a little later in this call, I go over six of the most common leadership strengths that women have that men may not have as much. And so I think it's really keying in on what those strengths are and then doing them as much as you can and focusing on them. I think a lot of times we focus on our weaknesses and what we're not good at. And so I'm all about figuring out, you know, what those strengths are that you have and then really focusing on them and making them really important as much as possible. One of the ones that women are really great at is collaboration. So we're all always looking to get, you know, the group buy-in, asking a lot of people for feedback. And that's a really important thing that kind of makes women unique and makes us great at a lot of the jobs that we have as leaders. Obviously, as women, you know, we're really great at attention to detail, too. And so that's another thing that sometimes men are not as detailed-oriented as women are. And so that's something to be really proud of and to really use it to your advantage, that detail-orientedness, that ability to multitask. You just want to make sure that it doesn't get into too much of trying to be perfect, because that's something that men don't like too when you try too hard to be perfect. And then another one too that I've witnessed in my career is that female intuition that women often have and that empathy that women can give. And so I think that would be, you know, my first advice to you would be to try and figure out what those strengths are that you bring as a woman and figuring out your unique leadership style so you can really be authentic, because that's really how you're going to be the best leader is when you're the most authentic in yourself.
So, Anna, why do you think women don't trust that? We don't trust that we can bring out those strengths and they'll be accepted or even thought well of. Why don't we trust that instinct?
I think for me it's more like I had to kind of learn it. Like it didn't just come natural to me. I think especially if you're in a male-dominated environment, you have a lot of male managers, and those are the managers you're watching. And so for me, I really didn't have a female manager to look up to see how hopefully things are changing now and there's a lot more female managers out there. But when I first started, all I had was that male manager, my male clients. I didn't have anyone that I respected as a leader to kind of model. And so I think that could be something of why we don't trust ourselves is because, you know, we aren't seeing that on top as far as, like, someone to model after. But I think it comes from understanding yourself, and it kind of goes back to the whole get unstuck system that I was talking about. If you don't understand yourself, you know, your interests, your skills, your strengths, what you're good at, it's going to be hard to be confident as a leader and to be authentic in who you are. And so I think it all kind of goes back to that is really understanding yourself better and really knowing who you are and being confident in that and not trying to be like, oh, I have to act like someone else. But you get there eventually, right?
Right, and I think you bring up a great point. I never thought about that before, but there are a lot more male role models up above the ladder than there are female. So that makes a lot of sense if you don't have that to kind of role model. Like you said, you're trying to somewhat figure it out yourself, and I think we all start out with trying to be like a male manager, only to find out that, yeah, if we trust who we are, if we trust, like you said, our self-awareness of our strengths, eventually all of that just really starts to work well for us.
Exactly. Yeah, it just becomes a lot more natural. And I realized I was really good at listening and mentoring and training people, that one-on-one, you know, that was really something I excelled at. And so zeroing in on those things that I was just really good at as a manager, as a leader, those are the things that I became known for then, and I became, you know, trusted and respected as that leader who really, you know, helped her team and mentored her team, and that's kind of what, you know, my reputation started to become. But it was all because I started understanding myself better and started, you know, doing more of those things that I did well and that I really enjoyed doing and was passionate about.
What would you say was the one skill that really propelled your career when you look back?
I think as far as like skills go, I think what I would have to say, the best thing I ever learned is when, and it actually came, one of my male bosses actually told me this, because I was working so hard on these projects and the guys in my office, they were having fun and joking around but I was in my cubicle just working my butt off and working so hard trying to get things perfect. And actually, it came from my male boss. He told me one day, it was kind of my rock bottom. I tell this story as kind of like my rock bottom, but he said, you know, Anna, you don't have to be perfect. And that was kind of like a light bulb to me. I was like, at the time, I was really mad.
Yeah.
I was really, really mad. because we work for a client, and the client expects perfection, I thought, and they do. But after that, I kind of thought about it more. You know, it took a little while for me to see how obsessed with perfection I was, and how, you know, it was hard for me to say no, and I was doing everything people were asking me to do, and it just got very, very stressful, and I was not happy at all. And so I think, I don't know if that's a skill, but it's definitely like a changing point in my career, a pivotal time where I learned kind of how to say no. I learned kind of what to focus on, how to kind of get to the 80% solution instead of the 115% perfection. And that eliminated a lot of stress. I started becoming a lot happier in my career. I started to kind of let down a little bit and hang out with the guys more, which, you know, that made my career go better too, because then I created that trust and respect with them, and they started liking me more and helping me more, and started to get into that boys network a little bit more too. So that was the really big thing, the really big key that really changed my career.
And did you feel like it set you up well for your next opportunity?
Yeah, I mean, that's something it's funny. I continue to think of that comment, you don't have to be perfect, you don't have to be perfect. Like, it's kind of something that runs through my head a lot, actually. Like, you know, just when people ask you to do things, I think it's kind of a female thing. We want to have people like us, you know, and we can get into that people-pleasing thing of oh, yeah, I'll do that. You go, oh, yeah, I'll do that, you know, and it's hard to kind of say no. And so, yeah, I think it's definitely kind of carried on with me as I continued to go in my career at the company I was working for. And then now, of course, in my own business, too, you do have to you can't do everything having your own business that you want to do, too. And so I've definitely learned how to say no there, too.
Very good. So tell us about your book.
Okay. So the book is called The Professional Woman's Guide to Managing Men. And basically it's a guidebook for any woman who is ever going to have to work with men. It's really going to help you, you know, gain that confidence, become assertive, kind of understand what your unique female leadership style is and what your strengths are. And then we also dive into some common management situations that you'll have when you're working with men, such as, you know, all the competition that goes along with working with men, the office sports talk, how to negotiate with men for success, and basically just how to earn that trust and respect that's really, really important when you're working with men. So it is about managing men, but it's also just about working with men in general. It's funny because some people have been saying that some of the advice about communicating with men can actually be used in your personal life too, like in your relationship.
That's my next question.
It's not something I aimed for. Like I'm not a dating coach. Warning, like that's not my specialty. I have a great marriage, but it's not my focus. But I think just learning how to communicate with men is a great thing to learn, you know, just for your success in your career. So that's the book, and it came out in February, and at one point we were at number 25 in the Amazon Women in Business category. So right up there with Lean In, which is really, really exciting.
Oh, that's wonderful. So I wanted to ask you, what do you think is most misunderstood about men in the workplace?
I think, it's kind of one of those things. I don't think there's necessarily anything that we don't misunderstand, but I think one of the biggest misunderstandings, I guess, I had was kind of that even though they're joking and they're laughing and they're having fun, it's still working to their advantage for their career. And so I think one of the things I thought when me and this other woman were sitting in our cubicles working our butts off and the guys were kind of joking around, I thought that, you know, we were doing better and we were getting ahead more than they were because we were working so hard. But you don't have to work so hard to get ahead. And what they were doing Well, they were building their boys network. They were building relationships, but they were also promoting themselves. And that was one thing that me and this other woman were not doing. We weren't promoting ourselves like they were. And so I think that was the biggest kind of misunderstanding is I thought, oh, hardworking, we're getting ahead more. But really, you know, a lot of them were actually getting ahead a lot faster than we were at that time.
And what does that look like when they're promoting themselves? What are they saying? What are they doing?
So they were born knowing how to do this, right? And as women, we're more humble, so it's a little different for us to promote ourselves, but it's really, really important. So basically, I mean, I think the most important thing that it just comes so natural for them. And so it's just like, it just comes out of their mouth. I did this. Like, oh, I got this score on this game, or this client gave me this feedback. And I have a good example, actually. There was a time, and I write about this in the book, there was one day where I was in my office, and I got an email from a man, and I got an email from a woman. And the man's email said, hey, look at this great thing I did. Like, you know, it was basically bragging about himself, right? And he sent it to the entire team, just saying, like, how great this project was. And it was really great. He has been working on it a long time, but he didn't hesitate at all to send that email to the entire team and tell everyone how great he had done. Whereas this woman, I had complimented her on this award that her team had gotten. And her email back was like, oh, you know, I wasn't even a part of that award. I had nothing to do with it. And she didn't even take any value in what she had brought to the team, which I know she had been working long, long hours. She had done great work. But I think that's a difference. As women, we tend to be like, oh, that's no big deal. Like, you know, I really didn't do that well, or I wasn't part of that. We don't want to attract that attention and promote ourselves. But when you're going for a promotion, guess which one's going to get promoted, that guy or the girl who's kind of like, oh, you know, that wasn't me. I wasn't a part of that award. So that's a big thing.
Yeah. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say that's kind of like a big difference that I see in the corporate world.
And what I'm going to ascertain is when the man sent the email, nobody blinked an eye. About this kind of self-promotion, right? They just say, hey, Bill or Steve, that's great.
Oh, yeah. And I did. I even replied back. I was like, awesome. You know, that's cool. I mean, everyone wants everyone on their team. Usually, you know, you want your teammates to succeed and your coworkers to succeed, and you're happy for them, you know. And so it is fun to hear that positive feedback coming from other people about how they're doing and to give them that reinforcement.
Yeah. No, I think that's great advice, because I also know that a lot of times women will talk more like, oh, it was a team of us. I mean, they're very gracious at giving credit to everybody. But to your point, then we're often bewildered, like, well, why didn't I get the promotion? Why wasn't I, seen as someone who's viable? But would you say, too, it's a way that you probably heard this expression before, but we teach others how to treat ourselves?
Mm-hmm.
Right. So in some ways, that's what we're teaching everybody is we're not deserving. We shouldn't get credit. Steve or Bill over here is more deserving. I mean, we're setting the stage, right, for not getting that promotion.
We really are. Yeah.
And I grew up, too, thinking, oh, actions speak louder than words. That's one of those beliefs that I know I've had circulating in my head. But in this busy world, people don't have time to really – know who's doing what. And so you have to do that self-promotion, because a lot of times people are just so busy that they're like, you know, I don't remember that Anna did this, but I remember Bill or Steve did this because they told me. And
exactly.
So sometimes I think you have to do that because people are so busy. They don't really have time to observe and watch and really dig behind the scenes of who's doing what and who's getting results.
Yeah, I think that's a common mistake, too, is to kind of think your manager is in charge of your career development and your career plan and your actions and your assessments, and, you know, and you're right. They're busy. They're not seeing what you're doing, and you got to go in there and you got to tell them, not just when assessment time is there or when you're up for promotion, but all throughout the year. You know, promotion decisions don't necessarily happen, you know, right then and there. You know, they're planning those promotions and those raises like 6 months beforehand. And that's something I realized. I thought, you know, oh, I could just put this together in a weekend and present it. But they need that time to kind of see you really taking action and wanting to be promoted and even asking for it. I think that's another thing that men are often doing, going into their boss's office, asking for that promotion, asking for the raise, you know, a lot more than women are. Have you seen that too?
Yes. Yes. And actually, my own, you know, I never went in and asked for much for myself. But one time I did share, you know, this is what I want, this is the role I want, this is what I'm working toward, and I got that role within 3 months. And I was surprised because that was the first time I really said, here's what I want. And, you know, of course I was working hard and doing all the things, too, to make myself promotable. But that happened to me much later than earlier in my career, and I'm like, why didn't I ask for what I wanted sooner? But you're right, the men are asking, the men are talking about it, and statistics will show that, you know, men will mentor with someone and say, I want to be the next, you know, chief financial officer. I mean, they'll just ask, how can you help me? Where women are like, you know, what development should I work on? What skills should I work on? Women, yeah, as far as what I've read is they don't ask for what they want. They'll ask for help in building skills, but they won't, you know, verbalize, this is the next job I want or the next role I want.
I think it's so important that you said it out loud, too, because, I mean, a lot of times we might think it, but when you verbalize that and say that out loud, it makes it, like, so much more real, too, and you're going to work a lot harder to make that happen because you've told someone about it, you know, and so that's just setting the intention of making that happen and that change happen, too, so I love that you said that.
Yeah, and there's this great quote by a motivational speaker by the name of Jim Rohn. I don't know if you've ever heard of him, but he said, if you don't design your own life plan, chances are you'll fall into someone else's plan. And guess what they have planned for you? Not much.
Yeah, he's great. I love the quote, you're the average of the five people you're around the most, by him, too.
Yes.
And
I think it's so wise. It goes back to your point. You've got to own your own career. Don't let anybody else own it. And, yeah, and just don't be afraid to work it.
Exactly. Yeah, you're really in charge of your own success and where you go and whether or not you stay stuck or not. I mean, I talk with a lot of women who are stuck, and it's really up to them to take action and to really take it to the next level because no one else can really do it for them. And that's definitely something I learned, too.
So that's a great point. You've talked to a lot of women about being stuck. What are the number one or two things that women get stuck around? What gets women stuck?
It has a lot to do with, you know, when you just kind of take it every day is just kind of another day, and it's just, you know, you don't really take that action to really learn more about yourself and that right career fit for you and, you know, where you want to be. I think as women, we end up, and I did this too, we stay in careers a lot longer than we should. I just spoke with someone right before this call who felt like indebted to their company because, you know, they paid for her tuition or, you know, they hired her out of college. And so we feel this, like, kind of this guilt or this indebtedness to other people. And it goes back to just what we were talking about, too. You know, you're in charge of your success. And if it's not something you're truly happy in and if it's not putting you in that right direction for your career growth, it'd be nice to stay there forever, but at some point you really got to figure out what that next step is going to be for your career and do it for yourself and for your future.
I think that's great advice because I am someone who has stayed too long too. And one of the statistics I was reading that men will, like if there's a job opening or an opportunity for promotion, men will apply for it or work toward it, even if they don't have 100% of the skills that are required. So if men have 60% of the skills, they're like, you know what, I'm still going to apply. I can learn the rest. where women mm-hmm. will want to be, they'll want to make sure that their skills map 100%+ to that new opportunity, a new role, before they'll even apply.
Exactly. Yeah, it's kind of, it's scary, and that's where I go back to now I have that 80% instead of 100% to, you know, if I can figure out, you know, make a decision with 80% of the information rather than 100%, then that's kind of the strategy I try and model now.
So do you think it's kind of that perfectionist mantra going on in our heads that we're not, you know, worthy to apply because we're nowhere near having all the expertise? Do you think that's part of that perfectionist mindset?
Yeah, I think it also goes back with, you know, not really seeing how much experience we truly have in our previous job experiences and roles. That's something I see a lot, too, is like, oh, you know, like you said, you can't apply, or a common thing I hear is, well, I don't have the experience. I want to make this career transition, but I don't have any experience. And then I'll keep asking them, you know, well, have you volunteered anywhere? You know, what types of skills have you learned that could apply to this job? And questioning them on that stuff, and it really brings up a lot more experiences that they have that they can really apply to that job. And, you know, sell during an interview, because that's the most important part. You want to sell those experiences that you have. So I think it's a matter of kind of looking deep and really truly seeing that they do have a lot of those experiences that's needed in that job.
So in today's world where, you know, you put a resume out on online, for example, and just trying to get your resume seen, what do you think is the best way or best step for women to get a job? Do you think it's more through a networking? What's your best advice for someone looking for a job? What's the best way to get in the door of a new employer?
It's not online, and it's not the resume. Like, we'll just start there. I think it's definitely, 80% of the time for job searchers should be spent doing networking, and 20% should be the online job search. And so when you think of it that way, I think that helps you kind of prioritize how you spend your time and where you spend your time. I was talking to someone just earlier today, and they were going to apply to one job every day in April. And I was like, I don't think that's your best strategy, because when you put your resume out there, it just kind of can go into a dead end. And so that's why I kind of created the Get Unstuck system, which kind of walks you through what we were talking about, understanding yourself, and then going through creating your career targets are really important, and then creating your personal branding strategy. So that's basically because all the recruiters are now Googling you, so you want to make sure that your online brand is consistent with where you're headed and where you're going, and kind of what you say when in an elevator pitch at a networking event. And then everything comes back to networking.
To networking. So tell us how to do an online brand. What would that look like?
Yeah, so basically your online branding strategy, so that's going to be an extension of your resume, but you want to make sure everything is consistent. And so the most important thing, because it's kind of the last part of my whole system, is you want to make sure you know where you're going first. That's one thing that keeps people stuck, too, is because they aren't updating their LinkedIn profile or their, you know, their online accounts because they don't know where they're headed. And so, you know, you might apply to like three different jobs, but they're so different that your branding strategy is all over the place. And so it's really important to first have that focus of where you want to go first. Once you have that and you figure that out and you have understood yourself better and your interests better and skills and all that stuff, then creating the strategy is really easy, because then you really know what direction you want to go in. And one of the best things you can do is kind of look at some of the job descriptions, look at the wording that they're using in those jobs that you really want, and kind of pick those out and see what those keywords are that they're using all throughout those job descriptions, and putting them on your, you know, on your LinkedIn profile, if you have a Twitter, if you have a Facebook. You know, you don't have to use, I don't want to overwhelm people. You don't have to use all those social media accounts, but you really have to know where your target market is. So where are those companies that you want to work for, and what social media platforms are they on? you know, are they on Twitter? Then you might want to get a Twitter account, and you might want to be following that company and kind of checking in with them and seeing, you know, telling them, hey, I just submitted my application. But you want to make sure that your bio on your Twitter matches your LinkedIn, matches your resume. So it's really about consistency.
Wow, that is great advice. And so, Anna, we only have a few minutes to the show. Tell us where we can learn more about you and the work that you do.
Okay, for sure. So everything, you can find all the information you need at classycareergirl.com. And I have a ton of resources on there. You can actually sign up right now for a free training course in my Female Leadership Academy, which I think your listeners will be really interested in. And so that leadership course kind of goes through some common mistakes that female managers make, and then how to really determine what career satisfaction means to you. And, of course, anyone's welcome to connect with me on LinkedIn or find me on Twitter. I'm at Classy Career on Twitter. And my book is on Amazon now, too, so you can get that. It's called The Professional Woman's Guide to Managing Men. So, yeah, definitely come find me. I run all my social media accounts, so it's really me. You can come say hi. I would love to. I would love to chat with you.
That's wonderful. And Anna, thanks for your time today. I learned a lot of great things. I took a lot of notes because
good.
I just thought what you provided today was some great advice. And not only for women, but for anybody who's wanting to accelerate and expedite their career. So thank you very much for being on the show.
You're welcome. It was fun.
And to the listeners, thank you for listening to Breaking the Glass Ceiling, Going Beyond Expectations with Dorothy Montgomery, and have a great week.
Hey, this is Anna, and thanks for listening to today's podcast. I just wanted to give you a quick note that if you want more tips and free ebooks about networking and job searching and interviews and resumes, and even some webinars that are free, of course, then make sure you check out www.freecareertoolkit.com. That's www.freecareertoolkit.com. Thanks. Have a great day.